Okay, so welcome again to the Introduction to PrecisionTree webcast. Pardon me, my name is Rishi Prabhakar, and we'll be today exploring several features of PTree. For some of you, you may not have actually worked with this product before, so we'll include information on what it is and what is the basic usage of it. We'll look at some of the more advanced ideas and analytics that PrecisionTrees enable you to do, and also utilizing it with other parts of the suite, in particular running simulations with at-risk. Likewise, I'll also show some of the new features in version 6 that either allow for new analysis or just make your life a little bit easier when you're dealing with PrecisionTree. Okay, so I've just started to share the desktop, and for those of you who might be following along on a separate laptop at your desk as well, and you'd like to actually work with the files that I'll be dealing with, once again, I'll be sticking to the example files that come with PrecisionTree. And so in this spreadsheet, we have a list of all of the example files that come immediately with the software. In terms of help or assistance with utilizing the tool and all of our tools, I'll quickly mention also that there are videos available for all of our products. Some of the videos are simply quick starts to get you going or get you across the general ideas of the tool, and then there are other specific videos covering very particular functions or features of the products. So feel free to explore those as well to help you. As with all of our new example spreadsheets, each spreadsheet comes with an explanation page, giving you an idea about what the file is about, how to use it, and so forth. Then the actual model and how you should then proceed using and analyzing that particular spreadsheet. So if you don't have the software in front of you or just watching the video, you can go back and do all these things yourself, but you don't have to work out how to use the model or any of our models. There are explanations and information there available to you. So let's start, before we actually go into looking at trees and building trees, let's see what is the use of a decision tree. Now, for the most part, modeling in Excel is a spreadsheet modeling, where we'll have perhaps cost modeling or cash flow calculations, these sorts of things. And we have a big, sometimes massive structure, lots of numbers, formulas, functions, and these feed into our bottom line figure. And spreadsheet models are very good at calculating. That's what they do. They have no concern about the level of complexity you wish to build into the calculation. Whatever it is, however many thousands, tens of thousands, millions of cells you've got, you will be able to end up with a calculation. What spreadsheet models don't do very well is change their structure. However, as we know, in real-world business situations, after you make a particular decision or after a certain event occurs or doesn't occur, the choices and events that you face after that can be completely different. This represents a structural change in the model of your organization, and one that a spreadsheet model may not be able to handle well. It's certainly, if you do build a spreadsheet model that can handle that change, it will look quite ugly. These things aren't easy to look at, understand, and see what's going on. Whereas a decision tree was designed with that in mind. And this is precisely what we will do with decision trees. We will chronologically map from left to right the decisions and chance events, logical considerations, logical decisions, down to the final endpoint of a project or program. Very simply, left to right, go through all of the options. It's incredibly easy to read, incredibly easy to show people, and as it turns out, quite easy to build and also produce very sophisticated analytics in there. So let's start by looking at a basic tree, and I'll start with basic tree terminology. If ever someone does ask you what's that in a tree, what's that bit mean, this is a good spreadsheet for you to go to. It's an incredibly simple model. Simply, should we buy a lottery ticket or not? And if we do buy a ticket, what happens? We either win or we lose. But in this example, we have all of the key features of a tree. We have the base of the tree. We have a node, a green square representing a decision. We have branches. The branches have names. The node has a name. The node has an expected value. We have a different type of node here, a decision node. There are different possible, sorry, a chance node, my mistake. A red circle is a chance node. We have different possible outcomes from this chance node. And we follow those branches, or any of the branches we're on, until we get to a blue triangle, which is an end node, and that represents the final state of our project, of our model. After any node, there will be coloured cells with words, values in them, and you see that these are P-tree functions. Unlike at risk, we do not put P-tree functions into the spreadsheet for ourselves. We build the tree using the interface, and these are included for us, so we never change those. What we will add are branch values to the tree, and in the case of chance nodes, branch probabilities. Everything else is calculated on our behalf. Let's look at a larger tree. Let's give you an idea of what a final model may indeed look like. In this case, I'm looking at an oil drilling example, and I'll zoom it out so we can see all of the tree at once. I don't expect you to be able to read that detail, but just to note that the tree moves left to right, chronologically going through different decisions and outcomes, possibilities, and ends up at different places. But it's very important to note that unlike other types of tree, there is no feedback looping into this tree. It absolutely positively moves from left to right chronologically, and it is therefore impossible to go backwards. We can't have this event occur, then get back to this point in time. Okay. So it's definitely a decision tree. In this particular tree, with a piece of land that we have, and we're an oil company, we are deciding, will we do more testing or not? So we can either not do any further testing or do further testing. You'll notice that next to test, it says true, and this is a decision function. All of the other decisions are given a false. This is because P-tree, using the rules that we've told it to, has calculated that we will get a better outcome if we actually make that decision. If we make the decision to do more testing, we will either get bad results, good results, or really good results. Then we have a decision to make about what we do with those results. Shouldn't be surprising to note that if the results are bad, P-tree suggests not drilling. If the results are good or very good, P-tree suggests we should go ahead and drill. And then we will either potentially still find no oil or find some or lots. Now, the only way that P-tree has made that decision is based on the values you've put into the tree in the first place. So if you're quite casual with how you pick your probabilities and so on, then you will get a non-robust, potentially meaningless, potentially harmful set of potential decisions. So as always, the information you put into this will be critical. On that note, we will see later, looking at sensitivity analysis, where we can actually specifically analyze what changes in some of these values will do to our decision and to our model. Let's start by building ourselves a tree, and as I build it, I'll explain what's being done. Now, I've mentioned the simplicity of the product before, and you'll see now just how easy it is to use. That's an exceptionally good feature of the software. You can basically build everything just with the mouse, and you build these very cool things just by clicking and knowing a few of the key input values. But don't be fooled into thinking that it is therefore a simplistic tool. As you'll see later, we can do some quite sophisticated work with it. So let's start by building a tree. Pardon me. I'll start with a tree, and what I will do is produce an example similar to the very, very quick example we saw previously, but I'll make a few changes to it. So let's look at a lottery example. So I start by building just a basic tree here, lottery. To actually build it, I left-click this base end node, and I select which type of node to use. Most commonly, you will use chance and decision nodes, and the default is an end node because that's simply what happens at the very end of the pardon me, of the sequence of potential outcomes. You simply have that final limiting state. So we'll start with a decision. And I'll click OK. By default, we have two decisions. And let's say the first decision will be to buy a ticket. And probably the smarter thing will be to walk away. If I walk away, obviously it costs me nothing. If I do decide to buy a ticket, perhaps here I'll add another decision, which is the type of ticket to produce, or sorry, to buy. So this is ticket type. And my tickets might be, pardon me, a standard game, sorry, I just wanted to check I had a space in there, standard game, or perhaps a systems entry. So far, so good. I'm making decisions. Now, however, if I purchase a standard ticket, it costs me $10. So I'm going to include this as a minus 10. The systems entry ticket, however, will cost me $45. Now, if I just pause here, you'll see that PTree has told me the true option, or the best option here, is to walk away. And if we look at the numbers right now, that's obviously true. If I were to buy a ticket, my only possible outcomes are to lose $10 or lose $45. The tree's not complete, but you'll note that as I'm building this, PTree is calculating the pardon me, optimal result for us as we go. Now, how is it doing that calculation? I'll go back to the base of the tree, left-click, and select the Calculation tab. Cumulative payoff is what's being selected. In this case, costs and, where appropriate, probabilities of costs and payoffs are simply combined, multiplied together to produce the average or expected impact at each node, and therefore PTree is making its decision based on that. Now, if I buy a standard game, what might happen after that? Well, now I have a chance node. Unfortunately, I don't get to choose whether or not I win the lottery, so instead I have my outcome. Let's say there are not just two possible outcomes here, there are three. So I add another branch, and I can, pardon me, edit my branch names and values and so on in this dialog, but I like to do it on the spreadsheet. So I might lose, which would be a shame, but it's a possibility. I might win, or I might win big. Let's say the chance of losing is 90%, the chance of winning is 9%. Now, before I finish off my chance nodes, please also note that value errors appear everywhere here. The reason for this is that by default, PTree says that your chance probabilities must total 100%. If they don't, it lets you know you've got an error somewhere by putting value errors in all of the calculations. But perhaps you've inherited a tree that had these errors and you don't know where the last spot was that someone put these numbers in, or you have these percentages as a function, and there might be an error somewhere else that's causing this issue. So how do you know where to look? There's a button called Model Errors. I click Model Errors, and it lets me know that the probabilities of node outcome in cell G9 do not add up to 100%. So if I had multiple errors, I could click to any of them here, click OK, and I navigate to that spot, and I can see that I need to include my 1% chance of a big win. Now that I've got 100% total probability here, I can, I actually get my model working. So, the win amount. Let's say that the standard win on a game there will be, say, $80. But the big win, that might be $400. Now, after I've put those values in, you'll see that the initial decision has now changed to buying a ticket. It says you should buy a ticket. You should buy a standard game. The reason it says that is that the expected outcome here is a $1.20 return. The possible outcomes are $10 loss, as in we simply don't win, a $70 return, our $80 win less the $10 ticket price, or a $390 return, $400 win less the $10. And these average quite simply to give me $1.20. So I could say 90% times minus 10, 9% times 71% times 390, that outcome is $1.20, and $1.20 is higher than minus 45, and it's higher than zero. Therefore, this becomes the true path. This is why PrecisionTree changed its decision. Now, we will come back and revisit this idea that if PrecisionTree is giving us the optimal decision based on expected value, doesn't that sort of fly in the face of the notions of intelligent quantitative risk modeling that we tend to try and put out there? That is, that looking at the average isn't actually doing risk analysis. We need to understand our potential downsides and so on. That's all true. But what PrecisionTree is giving us is a structure that we can perform that type of analysis with. Just because this currently says that's true doesn't mean the only set of outcome or the only output we get from this is the the buying of a ticket. That's what we will do. We will be able to compare the risk profiles of different decisions in exactly the same way as we would use the risk sim table function in an at-risk simulation. We will be able to get overlaying histograms and S-curves and decide which of our decisions has the most appealing risk profile, as an example. Okay, so I've built my tree so far to here. One more step, obviously, is to look at what happens after I buy a systems entry ticket. Now, the shape or structure after that point is the same. I have the ability to lose, win, or win big. The numbers might be slightly different, but the structure's the same. So to save myself some time, rather than building it again, I will right-click a node. Now please note that right-clicking anything in our software normally gives you lots of useful options, and in PrecisionTree there's no different. So I right-click a node, and you see there are various possibilities here, various options. What I'm going to do is to copy this subtree. I copy that tree, then I right-click my systems entry end node, and I paste the tree. It asks me if I'm sure I want to do that. I say yes. And you see now that it's put that structure there for me to work with. So now I don't have to rebuild masses of tree if it's exactly the same shape from different places. What I will do now is go in and check the numbers. So let's say that my systems entry, the reason I would purchase it, is it improves my chance of winning. So the win big probability doubles to 2%. The win probability goes up to 16%. And that leaves me with 82%, in terms of the probability of losing. So I've almost completely doubled. Actually, I will double it. I'll put that to 18 and make this just 80. So it doubles my chances of winning the big amounts. But you'll notice that the outcome, or the expected outcome, is still minus $22.6. So in this case, I would suggest that the cost of the extra, of the better chance of winning, hasn't actually made it worthwhile. Of course, if the win big value was a lot larger, doubling the chance of winning may indeed make this a worthwhile decision. But based on the numbers I have here, a standard game is better than a systems entry, and with a positive expected outcome, it's better than just walking away. Now, because this is a small tree, it's pretty easy for me to follow where all the true paths are. But PTree gives us the ability to actually make a report out of that, and that's called the policy suggestion. So I click policy suggestion. I can start at a particular place in the tree if it's large, or go for the entire model. I'll just ask for the optimal decision tree, click OK. And here I have a report letting me know what just the true paths were. Okay, so initially this is my result for what is your suggestion. You've done the analysis, what should the organization do? Well, here is what we should do. But I can also look at the actual risk profile. Now, generally, a risk profile or distribution exposure graph, you would expect that to be the result of a simulation. And clearly, we haven't run a simulation yet. However, we do have probability distributions in this tree. Whether you knew it or not, a chance node is a probability distribution. We have, in this case, three possible outcomes, each associated with a likelihood. That's a probability distribution. In at risk, this would be a risk discrete function where we have a finite number of potential outcome states. We know what the value of those states is, and we also know the likelihood of those states. So if I go to decision analysis and risk profile, I'm going to ask for information comparing all the branches of the starting node, or I could pick a just looking at the optimal path itself, but I'll go for all branches of the starting node. Let's get these results. Click OK. What this has created for me, obviously it's very simple because so is the model, but it's given me the equivalent of a histogram overlay comparing the two choices I had initially. Walking away was a $0 game, 100% of the time. Buying a ticket gave me a big chance of a small loss, but also some chance of some big gains. And whether people know it or not, this graph is essentially the rationale behind purchasing a lottery ticket. Those who've done training with me know that I do mention lottery tickets a fair bit as a little work example. But in this case, the liability is so small that even though there's a big chance of loss, it's okay because it doesn't represent a critical loss. If the lottery ticket cost $10,000, not as many people would play. And likewise, the wins here are very large. If your lottery, you know, Saturday's Powerball draw was for only $30, again, no one's going to buy a ticket in that. We want to know that our big chance of loss is matched by low liability and potentially massive gains. The report also produces an S-curve and then a few statistics as well. But for the most part, we'd look at the S-curve and the probability chart to give us an idea of what our exposure looks like and therefore what our decision best matches our risk appetite. Let's put that away. I will save this just in case I want to go back to it. But now let's look at some slightly more sophisticated examples than a simple lottery model. Let's see what we have here. One example I will utilize is the bidding decision example. In the bidding decision model, scroll out, we're looking at whether or not the organization should bid for a new job. Something's come up, should we bid for this? And we are comparing different bid possibilities with not doing anything at all. And you can see already that based on expected value, the optimal decision is to go ahead and bid. Yes has a true next to it. Now, if we do choose to bid, in this particular example, the decision is being made, should we bid low, a moderate level, or should we bid high? Now, what would be the impact of any of those decisions? If we bid low, but we win the bid, our margin will be much smaller. However, we should have a better chance of winning if there are competitors. So in this particular paradigm, you make your bid before finding out whether anyone else is actually putting up a competitive bid. There might be several parties interested, but you won't know until you've actually said, yes, we are going to bid $170,000, as to whether or not anyone else decides to go and compete. So after we've made a decision on what we will bid, if we do have to compete, then we either underbid our competitor or we don't. Obviously, the probability of winning is greater if we bid a smaller amount. If we bid top dollar, the chance that we would win in a competitive environment is, of course, reduced. But if we did happen to win, pardon me, then our returns would be much greater than if we bidded low. This is a standard compromise between being competitive and being profitable. Now, what results come out of this? We can see that the best decision on average is to go ahead and bid the moderate level. In this case, there's still a chance that we'll lose money in that we will lose the cost of our bid because we don't win, we got underbid in the end, but we might make money back as well. And this is what the distribution of the returns would be based on that optimal path. If I go back to the model, I can also get a risk profile of all branches for the starting node, and I'll just grab a probability chart. And so I see here the difference between doing nothing compared to actually bidding. That's pretty simplistic. But what about the different risk profiles of the three bidding amount decisions? Get a risk profile starting at bid amount. Now I'm comparing the returns, and there's a bit of overlay here, the distribution of returns based on our three different bidding strategies. You can see that it might be able to see a little blue cross in here because obviously the model's simple, so the numbers are on top of each other, representing the potential or the probability of losing if we bid small. But if we do bid small, good chance of making some money, but only a little bit, as opposed to, say, the large bid amount, which is the only way we could generate a high income, but also has a high probability of losing money because it's not such a competitive bid. On average, the moderate level bid worked out better, but it still has a very high probability of losing money. So if I go back and look at the optimal path, based on the current suggestion, there is a 48% chance that I will lose money. And so what PrecisionTree here is not ignoring the idea that expected values aren't a great decision-making tool. What it's letting you know is quite precisely the best decision on average has these sorts of outcomes and likelihoods. So in this case, there is a 52% chance we'll make money, $12,500, a 48% chance we'll lose money, but that number, 48%, that could be a key value. That could be something that the business would look at and say, there is no way we're going ahead and bidding on this. If that's the best decision amongst the different bid choices, then that's still unacceptable. Pardon me. So it simply gives you a structure to enable you to do that. Now, what if we get to this point and we say, on average, this one was better, but I liked the low probability of loss that the cheap bid gave me. So how can I do some analysis in which I guarantee that this is my decision? How can I force that choice? Well, we actually have a force option. I can left-click a node and go to my branches and tick on any branch that I wish to force. For the purpose of the next analysis, I want to explicitly tell Petrie, this is what you have to do. I also have the ability to right-click a branch itself and ask to force that branch. Either way, we note that a red branch is created. That now represents a forced branch. And it therefore also forces true to that path. Even though the expected value is lower, I've decided that the risk profile of this is better. So now I can again do my analysis. I can get a policy suggestion now for the entire model. And you'll see that it says that wasn't the best on average, but you forced it. And so now here is our risk profile. Note that the new probability of loss is down at 16%. It's more conservative in that we don't have as big a margin, but we have a much healthier probability of making money at all. Likewise, I can, pardon me, get, say, a risk profile for the entire model, comparing both sets of possibilities. So just to have a marker comparing doing nothing to what the now forced optimal tree is. Okay, so the reason I went through that process was just to try and reinforce the idea that the tree, once you've created it and put in your numbers, is not the end of the analysis, it's just the start. It's just the beginning. We want to be able to do things like this where we get feedback from management, feedback from clients and so on. This is what we would probably do at that point, no matter what the numbers say, or the averages look better, but there's too much risk in one of these options. So at that point, we'd probably go ahead and do this. And you can use things like forcing to ensure that you get results and reports that actually reproduce that information. Now, if I put this one away without saving it, another useful extension once a tree has been built is the question of sensitivity. If, for example, it became very expensive to place a bid, we might then find that the only meaningful bid value is a large one, or indeed, the cost of placing a bid is so great compared to the potential returns, we simply won't bid at all. However, if a bid was very cheap, we might decide that we can run the risk of bidding more because the loss, if we don't win, is small enough that we don't care about it. Likewise, in this particular example, these margins here have actually been calculated as the difference between the cost and the bid amount. In this case, we say that the cost of developing the equipment is, the internal cost. I won't get into the specific example itself, but the cost to us is $150,000. So if we bid $160,000, that's why we make $10,000. If we bid $180,000, the cost to us is $150,000, that's why we make $30,000. Now, if the cost to us, again, was to go up or down, how could that influence my decision-making? We have a sensitivity analysis option in Petrie. I'm going to utilize that now. The analysis has been run here already, and I've got the results here, and I'll show you those in a moment. are for a two-way sensitivity. This is where we are going to vary two of our potential variables at the same time and see what the combined effect of those is. Combined effect on two things. One, the actual value of our tree. So if these numbers change, how do our returns change? But another, and even more, I think, useful outcome is how might our decisions change based on different values that we see there. So if I look at the strategy graph, here's an example where as we have a changing cost of developing the equipment, how does the expected value of our tree change? Well, if we're not going to go ahead and bid at all, the tree is always worth zero. That's pretty straightforward. Doesn't matter what the cost of developing the equipment is. If we choose not to go ahead, it's irrelevant. However, as the cost of developing equipment goes up, if we did choose to go ahead and put in a bid, the expected value of the tree must go down. There's no other way around that. If it costs us more, if we decide to go ahead and do this, whether we lose the money by losing the bid, or we go ahead and we win the bid and we do it and we get our margins back, it must be reduced. And of key interest is this point here. Here we see that the cost to us becomes great enough such that on average we would have been better off doing nothing. And you see that it's around $156,000. This would be a very useful decision-making tool in terms of what do we think the probability is that this project might cost us more than $156,000. If that number is great enough, then we should decide now to not even bother going ahead and doing, putting in a bid. Because once the cost gets up to that sort of level, on average, we're going to be losing money. And that's win or lose. What you're looking at now is a strategy region plot. This is another very useful plot where it's comparing, it's looking at what happens when I change my two variables at the same time. This one here was just looking at changing the cost of developing the equipment. Here is the two-way analysis, looking at comparing the cost of bidding with the cost of developing the equipment. And it is color-coded here as to which decision would have been the best for those two things. So we saw in the first simple one-way changing, if the cost of developing the equipment goes over about $156,000, then no becomes the best solution. Here we look at two things at the same time. So the cost of development can get up to $156,000, and we can still make money if the bid cost is low enough. If the bid cost gets higher, then no, these little purple triangles, no would be the best solution. So this chart shows just how much of the solution space here for the different possible values of cost of developing equipment and cost of placing a bid, yes and no would be the optimal choices for. Now, what does this chart give us in terms of useful decision-making information? Firstly, the fact that so much of this graph is covered by no indicates that these two variables could change just a little bit, and we may well be in a region in which the optimal decision is to not do anything. Currently, the two values we've got at $7,500 and $150,000 sits here. And so the tree we're looking at says, yes, go ahead and put in a bid. But either of these could increase by just a little bit, and the tree would have said no. It shows that the optimal decision is highly sensitive to different values of these two variables. If, say, almost all of this was blue and perhaps there was a tiny little corner of purple triangles up in the top right-hand corner here, we could say the chance that both of our variables would both get up into that region is so low that almost always the best choice would be to go ahead and put a bid in. Okay, so if you can see how these tools, these sorts of reports start with our decision tree, but then it's one of the many ways of getting information out of it that simply looking at the tree doesn't tell us. As I said before, this is just the start. This is where we really start to add value to our organization. Okay, so just one more refresh on what this is looking at. It's changing the values of these two variables simultaneously and seeing for which pairs of values which decision would have been the best. And if we had three base decisions, then there could be three different colored regions here. If all of this was still the one color, it would say that no matter how much we vary these inputs, we should still make that optimal choice. Here we can see that it's almost 50-50. So the optimal decision just happens to lie just on this side of yes, but it could just as easily have been a no. This would say to us that there is a lot of uncertainty about whether or not we should go ahead with this project. Perhaps we need to look at something a little more robust, or we need to try and reduce our cost of the equipment or reduce our bidding cost. If we get in this region, we'd be far more confident that indeed we should go ahead and put a bid in. Okay, and that's the sensitivity analysis. I'll run a one-way sensitivity as well, just to show you another chart that, pardon me, we haven't seen. So it's strategy graphs for both. We saw one of those before. But we can also compare a big list of variables in a classic-looking double-sided tornado. So this bar represents the range of values that are the maximum of these two bars, the maximum of the blue bar and the maximum of the, maximum of the blue bar here and the maximum of the purple bar here. And the spider chart tracks those two as well. So we can compare dozens of variables simultaneously in tornado chart or spider chart form, or simply two at a time in terms of looking at the decision strategies here. So I'll put that model away. now just a quick word on where we can get these numbers from. The most common issue or concern people have with understanding decision trees is actually understanding the probability of a particular outcome. Now, unfortunately, no piece of software can actually help you with that directly. Either you have data or you have an idea that something is rare or common and so on, or you don't. But the sensitivity analysis option that we just looked at can be used to help you understand how important it is to understand a particular probability. So for example, if I look at my bidding decision tree, I have here 80-20, 40-60, and 10-90. Where in each case, the probability is one of them is a function of the other. So I could adjust 90, 60, and 20 in a parameter table here and see, well, what values of losing here, what values of this losing probability might change the value of my tree, might change my decision. If, for example, this could be anything from 0 to 50% and it still wouldn't change our decision, then it didn't matter what value it was in that region. If, say, however, this one, if it got down to 55% chance of losing we would go for a different choice. Or if it got up to 65%, again, like if the number we had in there was quite sensitive in terms of the overall decision or outcome, then that lets us know that we need to do further analysis to get those numbers. Okay, but nothing can ever protect you from needing to be able to find information and create data. No software, no system, no technique says you don't have to know anything. But what I have used sensitivity analysis for in the past is checking which of the possible variables or uncertainties in my model are important enough to go and get better information about. Okay, and that's probably the best answer that question can have in terms of, well, it's fine to, you know, these have already got numbers in there, but what if I don't know what they are? Well, the question you should ask yourself is, why don't you know? You're a subject matter expert. If there is something in a tree that's not something that you're an expert in, well, then someone else in your organization should be. We can never simply hope that we will get a useful decision or an intelligent choice or good information without actually having good information in the first place. So I'm going to put this tree away. Actually, then I'll reopen it again. I'm going to show you another extension idea in the use of decision trees. Now, we saw before that the calculation was just cumulative. So it looks at the expected value, pardon me, as calculated using the probability and so on, any costs along the way, that calculates and works out what the expected value of each node is, therefore the expected value of each predecessing node, and therefore which are the best choices to make. It's all very straightforward. However, as we know, averages aren't necessarily a great way of making a decision. In fact, they certainly aren't. So one way around that is to utilize the notion of utility. Now, there's a theory around utility, and I won't go into the technical details of it, but the basic idea is that it hurts more to lose $100 than it makes you happy to win $100. That's the basic idea of risk aversion. We would rather, pardon me, say on the toss of a coin, we wouldn't be necessarily happy to win or lose $100. But on the toss of a coin, if we could win $100 and maybe lose $30, and we figured that that was pretty even, that gives us an understanding of, to us, what the utility of money is. It's basically a way of factoring in risk aversion. So if I, pardon me, ask to use the utility function, let's make a few changes here. So now I've said, yes, I want you to punish losses a bit more. Don't make it just even so that $100 loss is the same as a $100 gain. And if I zoom in here, I see that it now asks us to not go ahead and bid. Now, the returns that are shown here on the tree, these look like funny numbers, and they are. They're the utility values. They're the expected utility of the decisions. So we saw before that we had very high probabilities of losing money, and those high probabilities of loss have punished this part of the tree such that we have a negative utility, which is obviously worse than zero utility. So now the tree tells us to not go ahead and put a bid in. Okay, so I won't go into the details of the utility function, but please note that's another sophisticated extension to the calculation methodology that allows you to include the very real notion that we would rather, pardon me, that we'd have to be able to make a lot more money than we could lose for us to go ahead and do something. 50-50 deals tend not to be acceptable, especially if the loss is large. Okay, so I'll put that away. Now, that example of using utility was one way of changing the calculation. Let's look at a couple of extra ways of changing calculations to, again, add more sophistication to our modeling. The first one I'll look at is the payoff formula idea. Now, this tree looks similar to what we've seen before. However, if I go to calculation, you'll see there is actually a formula in the payoff calculation area. It used to, we've seen cumulative payoffs before, but now we're using a payoff formula. Now, this payoff formula uses key phrases such as branch val, and then the names of different nodes to determine what the payoff is. Now, this tree is currently not calculating any different to what the tree would be originally. This is shown as an example of how to build a formula for an entire tree that potentially takes values and does different things to them than simply multiply them all. For example, if you were looking at an oil model, you might not have a dollar value here for large well, you might have barrels of oil. So you need to convert barrels into a dollar amount before you could do a comparison. I know it's quite simplistic, but that's the idea that this number may not be in the same scale as this number. So payoff formulas are a way of changing that. We can also put payoff formulas directly into a branch. Pardon me. Sorry. Oh, I was looking there, sorry. I'm looking for a button on. Haven't been able to find it. No, not the definition type. Sorry, I will remember that is and show it to you later. You can also apply a payoff formula directly into a specific node, and that allows you to say this node will be calculated based on multiplying the branch values by some specific number or some other functional formula. So you can produce payoff formulas both at the node level or with the entire tree being calculated. To go even further, we can get a calculation. Pardon me. That is a VBA macro. So here's one example of using VBA code, which basically has no limitation on how complex you'd like to get, and taking the values that the tree finds as it goes through its paths based on chance nodes, based on decisions, and uses actually a macro calculation. So again, this is a simple calculation, but there's the macro code that will be used to calculate the value of the tree. So we can get quite sophisticated in that way. But potentially one of the most useful advanced calculation techniques is the linked spreadsheet. Now, the way a linked spreadsheet works is not just by using cell references. We've seen already that a tree can include cell references to a parameter table and so on, or the probabilities can cell reference each other to make sure everything adds up to 100% and so on. But referencing isn't what linking does. The idea behind linking is that we will build a spreadsheet model for the purpose of calculating. I mentioned before that spreadsheet models are good at being calculators. But in this particular tree, we have we have 16 different possibilities, 16 different end nodes. So to calculate the MPV of this particular oil process, I would need to put in 16 different sets of values into my tree to find out what the outcome is. Now, a linked tree allows you to calculate things such as a discounted cash flow value as the payoff in a tree. And it does that by getting you to determine which parts of the tree would be the equivalent of sections in the in the spreadsheet model itself. So now we have barrels of oil rather than dollars worth of oil here. We have amount of oil produced, and of course there's some exponential decay there. We've got the price of oil, we've got operating expenses and so on, net profits, taxes if relevant and so forth. So for example, the test decision node is linked to cell C4. Cell C4 is the cost of testing. So if the tree was to actually try and find the value of not testing, it would put a zero in that cell. Likewise, drilling. Drilling is linked to C5. So you can see what's actually happening is the tree itself is substituting its own values into this spreadsheet structure, into the appropriate places, and then running the calculation to get what the value at the end node would be. And then finally, the amount of oil found is also linked to how many barrels of oil were found. So if I look at this cash flow model at the top, this cash flow model at the top here, I see that it says, let's do testing at $55,000, drilling at $600,000, and we find 35,000 barrels of oil. Gives an NPV of 1.19 million. Now, where can we find that in the tree? If I were to go ahead and do testing, and then I drilled, and then I found 35,000 barrels of oil, you notice this is the same value here. So the tree itself is now comparing and calculating discounted cash flow values. This allows us to have trees that aren't doing these simplistic probability multiplied by outcome calculations. It's actually performing something very sophisticated. So it happens to be here discounted cash flow. It could be something else. And likewise, you have the payoff formulas and VBA code formulas for calculating more complex results. Now, we have a lot of oil drilling examples, and we always have with PrecisionTree, because oil and gas organizations use PrecisionTree a lot to map out their projects and decisions. But we do have a few other examples here. All of these have real-world basis to them. Some things are more complex, such as pricing an American put option. Now, that may or may not be the sort of model you do, but just so you know, this is an example of how sophisticated the modeling can be, despite the fact that decision trees themselves are very simple to work with. Three-day put pricing options and so on. You can see the tree is getting quite large, but it's taking this sophisticated piece of data and displaying it to us, in a reasonable manner. Okay. So I might just quickly grab the policy suggestion for this one. And it's showing me if, you know, the price goes up, we don't exercise. Price goes up, we don't. Price goes down, we don't. We don't exercise at all in that case. If it goes down initially, no, up, yes. So we have ourselves a set of decisions that we should make cut out of a much more complicated tree. And this would be our resulting rule. Okay, here's our strategy. Another nice example is a drug development one. This is an R&D example with a pharmaceutical company looking at whether or not they should do phase one and two of the program, i.e. pilot it themselves, contract that pilot phase out, or license the drug straight away. If they license it straight away, they'll either make a little bit or a little bit more money. If they contract it out, there's a chance that the phase one and two will be unsuccessful, and so they might lose money. If it's successful, then you can choose to manufacture it yourself or now license this now successful drug, and so on. Quite a neat little complex structure here. And based on this cash flow information that we've generated previously. Okay, so again, just showing that the trees, while simple to build and simple to read, just left to right, they can be used to represent or model some quite complex situations. Another use of precision tree that I have seen is initially in the brainstorming workshopping phase of a program, we put down a decision tree to understand everything that might happen. Just look at all the possibilities. We might even put some rough numbers in. And then either based on that or based on doing a sensitivity analysis, we determine which are the numbers that require or deserve some more complex modeling. So those parts might go and get cash flow models built into them, maybe project cost models. We might look at building a risk register and maybe putting some of those elements into the tree. And then when all the analysis that's done in these large spreadsheet models is complete, the results then get imported back into the tree to then represent a handful of pieces of information about that wrap up all of the information that was in these disparate spreadsheet models, simulation models, and so on. We put the results back in here and do very simple, policy suggestions and so on, simple risk profiles to reduce the complexity of the results. Everyone can understand a tree, so if you can put results back into a tree, no one will be confused by what's going on. It all seems very, very simple. We should do this, then do this, then do this, and here's the numerical reason why. Pardon me. So the tree as a communication device is another way in which I've seen it used. Pardon me. I'll move on now to looking at... Pardon me. Some of the new features in version 6. Now, there are some examples here showing some of the new features. One feature is Bayesian revision. Just to let you know what Bayesian revision is all about, is the idea that sometimes the way in which we think about values isn't actually chronologically the way in which they occur. So, for example, if we're doing drug testing, we get the results of the test first before we know or have any way of knowing if they were a user or not. Okay. So we may need to, pardon me, a few different examples here showing different, more complex options. But the idea being that if someone returns, for example, a positive test result, what is the chance they're actually going to be a drug user? So we know what the, say, positive the number of positive tests are, but if you get a positive test from an in-office drug testing round or something like that, what's the chance you are actually a drug user? So these priors and so on can be difficult to work out. So now I've revised the tree by going to Bayesian revision. By going to Bayesian revision and doing the flip, and you see that positive and negative now comes chronologically first. So if they receive a positive test, the probability they're a user is only 62%. If they receive a positive test, therefore there's a 38% chance they're actually still a non-user. In other words, we have here the false positive probability. I'll move that back to where it was. Whereas previously, we had here 93% chance of testing positive, but that was conditional upon them actually being a user. There was also a 3% false positive testing of non-users, but these numbers don't look anything like the mathematically correct revision, which is if you receive a positive test to begin with, there's actually only a 62% chance that you will be a drug user. Okay, so the ability to do a Bayesian revision to switch those trees around for certain applications is quite invaluable. Another new feature, pardon me, or just a couple of new features. Now these simply make your life a little bit easier. One is, if you start to build a tree and then realize that you needed to include a node somewhere inside it. Previously, it was quite difficult to do this. It was quite hard to just shove a node in here. You'd copy and paste, move it around, and build it back. Now, instead, I can simply right-click, insert a node, and there a node's been inserted. So my old chance nodes are still there, my decision node from before, and then a new node's been put in, and I can make it whatever sort of node I'd like. So it's very easy to do. Another thing that's easy to do is build big trees. A tree of this size can be built in a matter of seconds, and then even if it's not of the correct structure, we could go in and maybe delete a branch here or there. So how do we do this? This is known as the append tree option. Okay. So I ask to append a tree. I click on my tree, I append a tree. I'll start with a node. This will just be the first decision. It will be a decision node, and maybe it has two branches. Then after each of those decisions, there will be some chance node, a set of chances. But maybe there are three chances. And then after each of those chances, perhaps there's another round of decisions that we might need to make. Decision round two. This is a decision node. And again, there are two decisions need to be made here. And then maybe after those decisions, there will now be a second round of chance possibilities, and those have just two possible outcomes. So I click OK, and PTree has gone and built that tree for me. So you can see how massive that is and how long that would take me to build that structure. But by starting with a base tree, just a one branch and an end node, and clicking a pin tree, I can make something much larger. So if I did need to maybe get rid of one or two of these options just to keep things logically correct, I could, but that's a very quick way of building a large tree very easily. Now, another aspect that's useful in working with trees is that when a tree gets like this, that can make it difficult to know where you are and what you're trying to look at and do. But what you can do is right-click a node and collapse everything behind it. So I collapse those child branches now, and you see it's all gone. Everything but now. I've got a plus that I can use to make it large again, but otherwise now I'm just looking at the parts I want. So maybe I'll collapse that as well. Maybe even collapse this one. And so now I'm just left with this part of that otherwise massive tree, and now I can do some work in here, just to make it a bit easier to navigate around PTree. Okay, so I'll put that away. Actually, one last thing I will show, my mistake, I said that was the last. I wanted to show you using at-risk with, in conjunction with PrecisionTree. So if I look at the simple example, we have a very simple model that includes some probability distributions. I'll go and load at risk, of course, so we can actually see what we're looking at here. I have probability distributions for the returns of various branches in my tree. Now, this example file is very useful because in the simulation section of a tree, there are various options. In each iteration, do we calculate expected values or values of one sampled path, and do we go through one of these three different path options? Essentially, we need to tell PTree what to do when at-risk puts different numbers on the spreadsheet. Okay. Now, this example file gives you a description of what each of those five possible options are, an idea of what the data would do and what the relevance of that might be. Now, one basic idea, and this will be the most common use of at-risk in simulating a tree, and that would be looking at values of one sampled path through the model following the current optimal path. This will be the single most commonly utilized feature. What it shows is, based on the current set of decisions, what are the actual possible observable future data points going to be? And therefore, I'll be generating my risk profile, just as you would without thinking about it using at risk. But we have to think about things a little bit more carefully here, because we have a decision tree model, and by their nature, they might change. So if I were to simulate here, if you look at where the true and false outcomes are, PTree is simply going to pick the branch or the decision with the best expected value. But it's usually not going to be the case that you know what the future will entail. So PTree shouldn't change its decision based on this outcome, because you didn't know what the outcome was to change it. That's why the most common option will be to follow the current optimal path. It is possible to change the decision based on expected values if you have the potential to understand or to gain information during the life of the tree. You might actually know what some of the new expected returns could be in different for different options, and therefore maybe you could change your decision. So we might have this sort of decision. The option to look at expected values of the model, this is essentially going to generate a distribution of the expected value. So if you're interested in knowing what the average return would be like, we can create for you a distribution of the average return. But again, I think that this option will be more useful, because we would like to know specifically what are the things that might happen. Okay. So what I'll do here is, you'll note that there is an output function in my tree. I have set my tree, my simulation settings, to follow one sample path through the model, and the decision has to stick with the current optimal path. I run a quick simulation, and I now have the distribution of potential outcomes based on, in this case, the play safer option. Okay, where I have particular chances of good or bad outcomes, but the distribution of returns in those is a safer outcome itself. So I still have a chance of losing and so forth, but this looks at, or this produces data in my output here, of every observed value that was in the tree. Okay, so now I can take a step beyond the basic risk profiles that we saw before and look at very specific probabilities and percentiles of outcomes, and have that make a lot more sense now. Okay, so you can simulate a tree, because our products can speak to each other. They know what they're talking about, but you do need to be careful to make sure you have the right simulation options that make sense for you. So please look at this using at-risk with PTree, this simple example. The example is very, 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 very easy, but the descriptions there for the different possibilities you'll find very useful. Okay, so I'll put that away. Okay, so we've reached the end of our time here for this quick introduction session into PrecisionTree. A quick wrap-up of the basic ideas. Decision trees model changing decision structures incredibly well. That's what they're designed to do. Spreadsheet models don't do that so well. So if you have anything that could be described as a real options style environment, and that doesn't mean it has to be financial, it just means that you will make decisions down the track based on new information, then you're probably in the situation where you have a decision tree type structure for your project, for your business, whatever it is that you're looking at doing. We've got several examples here of the sorts of things that you might use PrecisionTree for. If you do, you saw how easy it was to actually construct a decision tree using PTree. It's all just mouse clicking. Because it's on a spreadsheet, you can use functions for things like the probabilities. You can put at-risk functions in to put distributions in for the returns or costs of any particular branch and so forth. And, you know, run a simulation if you need to. But the building of the tree is just the starting structure. It doesn't really tell you anything. After that, you are then going to do sensitivity analysis. You're going to look at different options, different risk profiles. You're going to force particular paths and see what the effect would have, what the impact would have if business made this decision at this point in time, even though it wasn't the best based on the expected values. If you don't like expected values because you want to include some notion of risk aversion, you might look at the utility as an option, looking at the utility values of the decisions. You might also build your own custom payoff formulas and functions as well. Okay, so I hope that's given you a bit of a taste for what PrecisionTree can do. As I said, please, I encourage you all to explore it. It doesn't take very long to learn all the buttons. There aren't too many here, too many things to play with. But the things you can do with PTree, well, that's indeed quite a rich place to go exploring. So please have a look at the example files and the videos, video tutorials online. And as I mentioned before, if you do have any ideas for future webcasts you'd like us to do, please just contact our office or contact us for any question that you may have. Pardon me. As I said, please simply email our office directly, or Duncan Hickman or Freeman Liu, depending on your geographical location. Also, all three of the webinars that were given delivered this week will be available, I believe, from next week onward on our website. So if you'd like to look at it again, you had to step out, or there was a part that you just want to listen to one more time, please just feel free to go and watch those recordings then. Otherwise, thank you all very much for attending these days, and hopefully we'll either get to speak to you in a web format again soon, or even better, face-to-face. We're doing some training or consulting or some collaborative effort. That'd be fantastic. So thanks again, and enjoy your weekends.